Oh my god, y'all. I am obsessed with this one. I'm sure most of you have heard of Hades, currently in early access from Supergiant Games. The game got a pretty hyped reveal at the Cringe Fest Game Awards in December, and it comes from the same people who made the phenomenal Bastion, even more phenomenal Transistor, and 2017's Pyre. So fans of those games have been talking about Hades pretty voraciously. I played and finished Bastion a little while after its release and regard it very highly, but will admit that I actually never picked up Transistor or Pyre, so I can't speak personally to whether they match the reputation. Though I will say that Supergiant has a strong stake in the industry for creating beautiful games with striking art design, and marrying their stylistic choices with inspired musical scores and unique combat systems, all themes that are continued and amplified in Hades. Two things immediately separate Hades from these other titles, though. Hades is the first roguelike game Supergiant has ever made, and it's also the first one they've ever released as an early access title. A few years ago, it seemed as if every AA development studio in the world was making roguelites, in the same way the industry has globbed on to battle royale games now. The genre suits small teams perfectly because they are by their nature able to reuse content and assets in ways other types of games can't, while remaining fun the whole way through as long as the gameplay is able to stand up on its own. Most take advantage of procedural generation to extract every last scrap of utility from every map, item, or gameplay feature. What makes these games memorable is the minute-to-minute gameplay. The very act of interacting with these worlds needs to be fun and engaging. I'm sure most of us know that very few of them actually accomplish this. I've played a lot of shit roguelites in my time. Very, very few of them actually transcend into excellence. Last year saw the release of one of the all-time greats, Dead Cells, whose release was marred by IGN writer Philip Mewson plagiarizing his review from Boomstick Gaming. Philip Mewson is an ass clown not only because he ripped off a smaller channel and then doubled down on it, but also because of instead of the industry talking about how good Dead Cells was, they instead were covering IGN's fall from grace. The reason I bring this up now is because Dead Cells was my favorite roguelite that I'd ever played, and I played that one through its early access period also. After having consumed all the available content that Hades has on offer, I think it may have toppled the crown from Dead Cells' head, and I really, really want people to know about this one. As mentioned, for a game like this to succeed, it has to be fun to play moment to moment. It needs to throw you into the action repeatedly and mercilessly, and then it has to hold your attention by having an engaging progression, both through unlocks for your character and the weapons you wield. And this is where Hades shines brightest, propped up even further by an interesting story and characters commonly absent from these kind of titles. The player controls Zagreus, prince of the underworld and son to Hades himself, as he attempts to escape the underworld and make it to Olympus, where he can join the other gods of the Greek pantheon. Zagreus is an angsty, smug guy, but over time you discover he has more depth than you would have initially thought, and this is revealed by brief but illuminating conversations with different underworld denizens, famous Greek mythological figures, and of course the rest of the Olympians themselves. Supergiant's take on these characters is a highlight of the game, because each of them has a very distinct personality and style, with everything from their portraits to their dialogue dripping with flavor. The devs really flex everything they've learned from their other games, because just interacting with these characters is often as much a motivation to talking to them as the abilities they offer you. That's an incredibly rare feat, even more so for the roguelike genre specifically. Each escape attempt you make will see you receiving various boons from different gods to help you along your way, and because of this, you'll wind up with extremely diverse builds as you press forward. Very soon after beginning, Zagreus will have four weapons he can wield: a sword, a spear, a bow, and my favorite, a throwable shield, a la Captain America. Each of these weapons has unique traits and two different attack styles that force combat into a quick flurry of almost trance-like attack patterns. The complexity of what you can build into becomes apparent once you start mixing in the various Olympian gifts, and then really explodes when you stack several boons on top of each other. As an example, let's say Zagreus begins his run using his shield. He finds a Daedalus hammer early on that allows his shield to hit four targets at a time before returning instead of the usual two. In the next chamber, he talks to Ares, who makes the shield put a chunk of time damage on enemies each time the shield strikes. A few rooms later, he runs into Aphrodite, who gives him the ability to throw a debuff on each foe the shield touches that reduces their damage. Now your shield is doing some pretty insane things on each bounce, already a pretty damn strong ability. But uh-oh, now you find yourself in front of Zeus himself, who allows you to call down a lightning bolt onto each shield slam. Now, each time you toss your shield, it's doing its normal damage, hitting 4 targets at a time, infecting them with a timed damage bomb, debuffing their damage, and striking them with lightning damage all at once, and you still have many additional boons left to find during your attempt. You see what I mean? This can get absolutely bonkers, and every run is different. Different weapons, different boons, different enemies, different paths, and different unlockables. These are things that make Hades shine with the burning fires of all the underworld can offer. The player is given control in the way that they choose to play by not only allowing them to choose their weapons, but allowing them to choose from one of 3 different boons each time they encounter an upgrade possibility. You can really tailor your build to a specific playstyle, or if you're like me, experiment with all sorts of wacky combinations, really testing the limits of the game mechanics. During your runs, you'll pick up a few different currencies, modes of darkness that allow you to buy persistent benefits that last for all of your runs, gold coins that let you buy abilities or consumables from the various shops you'll come across during runs, or ambrosia, an item that you can gift to all the other characters to advance individual storylines and relationships. Did I mention that when you gift ambrosia to another character, oftentimes they'll give you a keepsake that you can equip during your run that will offer a wide range of additional benefits, and can even be further upgraded the longer you use one to expand those benefits, making you even more powerful. All of this combines together into a beautifully organic system designed to keep you returning to the action over and over again, and most importantly, keeping it feeling fresh and new every time you start a run. The gameplay loop will see you making your escape attempt, pushing further and further each time, collecting various currencies until your inevitable death. You will be resurrected in the Palace of Hades, where you can then check in with the wide variety of NPCs, advancing their dialogue and gifting ambrosia, and then spending your darkness at Nyx's mirror to unlock persistent traits, such as doing increased damage if you attack from behind, or allowing you to survive a death blow during an escape. After you've done everything you want in the palace, you can immediately begin a new escape. This downtime is so appreciated. It allows you to soak in the amazing art and characterization Supergiant has built into the game, all while figuring out what general strategy you want to utilize during your next run. I could literally talk forever about the amazing builds you can create, the variety of paths to choose from, and the power trip that you're going to feel because of them. For instance, every time you receive a boon, there is a chance of getting a rare, epic, or even legendary option that has increased or unique effects. And while they offer you 3 choices at a time, each different god and upgrade has a pool of 10 or more possible selections that can appear. If you happen to get the same upgrade to show up from running into the same god a few times, you can reselect it to supercharge the upgrade effect even further. There are literally hundreds of different combinations of effects and upgrades and boons that you can find. Maybe instead of progressing normally, a bloodgate appears that you can enter at the cost of some of your health. And inside the Bloodgate, you run into Primordial Chaos, who offers riskier boons, such as a 50% increase to the gold you find for the duration of your attempt, at the cost of taking 50% increased damage for the next 3 chambers. Perhaps you enter the next chamber and you have a choice between Poseidon and Artemis, but choosing one enrages the other and causes special imbued enemies to appear. I hope that you're getting the picture here of just how many possible factors contribute to the experience of a single run, because for an early access title like this, it's truly staggering. All of these amazing gameplay benefits would mean absolutely nothing without an appropriate challenge to use them against, and Hades delivers on this front too. There is a wide offering of enemy types that all do different things, have different strengths and different weaknesses. As you'd expect, each run becomes progressively more difficult as you move from encounter to encounter, and you'll become more skillful and knowledgeable over time, learning how to dispatch each enemy as quickly and safely as you can. For a while, you'll struggle greatly to reach the first mini-boss, and then the first boss. And then as you leave Tartarus for Asphodel and encounter new enemies and bosses, you'll struggle there too. The game can be punishing, and gets increasingly more so over time. Between the varying enemies, wildly different builds, staggering number of keepsakes and boons, level design, and potential choices, the game is a never-ending dance of combat prowess and inevitable death, a cycle that is incredibly fulfilling and rewarding for the player. This game hasn't even seen a full release yet, and it's already my favorite game of its type. I haven't even gone into detail about the game's artistic leanings and its truly phenomenal soundtrack that plays behind everything that you do. Nor have I gone into great detail about build or weapon specifics because I truly think it's something best discovered on your own. Obviously, you will have gleaned some idea of it all just from watching the gameplay footage I've shown here, but it all pales in comparison to experiencing it firsthand. The last thing I want to cover with some detail is the nature of its early access release. The reason Supergiant has gone with this type of release schedule for the first time is because this is a title that will live and die on the balance of its difficulty and its character building. I count myself very fortunate that they decided to do it this way because it means that we get to play it from the beginning as they build it brick after brick. As the game stands now, it offers between 15 and 20 hours of fulfilling gameplay, even more for those who want to unlock as much progress as they can before subsequent updates. Supergiant is sticking with a transparent model with their patch schedule and have committed to major content patches monthly. In fact, they have a countdown timer constantly ticking off days till the next major patch at the bottom of the game's menu, a timer that I greatly appreciate and watch religiously. It will take you some time to get through Tartarus and Asphodel. Their respective bosses will halt your progress time and time again until you're finally able to defeat them, let alone consistently. And yet there are many more regions and bosses to follow. What's available of the game so far is only a fraction of the overall project, and it is already more content than what you could expect from other games at their $20 price point. Don't be discouraged by the early access nature of the title's release. I've put about 20 hours into the game so far and haven't come across a single bug that interfered with my gameplay or progress. And Supergiant have said that they will not be doing any save file wipes as they push out more and more content. Supergiant is exactly the kind of development studio I like to support. Only focused on delivering superb content on their own terms and without any greedy publishers or outside influences trying to muck up their titles with microtransactions or greedy monetization strategies. If you've ever played anything from them before, or have had your interest piqued by what you've seen, then I encourage you to keep your eyes on this project. It is available right now on the Epic Games Store, exclusively on PC and slated for a full cross-platform release upon it hitting version 1.0. If you have the money and want to experience something truly engaging, I emphatically recommend you give this one a go. Thank you guys for checking out my channel. I very much appreciate it. If you liked what you saw, please make sure to like and subscribe. And if you want to know first when new content is uploaded, make sure you hit the notification bell. I'd love to know what you guys think about Hades, and am up for some thoughtful discussion down below, so feel free to drop your thoughts down in the comment section. Again, thank you for visiting For the Quinn, and I will catch you guys next time.